Thank you, Dr. Doherty.
Thank you.
I believe that. I believe that. Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
People need to know that, or maybe.
I can mention it.
Okay.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you for being here tonight. I'm Jean Borowski. Thank you for going through what's a very thorough interview process. I should let you know that we are being videotaped, so we're on local television, RCTV. And I'd like to introduce you to my colleagues, Gary Nyan, Julie Joyce, Chuck Robinson, Linda Snowdoxer, and Elaine Webb. We've all had an opportunity. You too. We've all had an opportunity to look over your resume and your qualifications. I understand you've met Julie. She was our representative on the first round.
On the phone, yes.
So it's great to see you face to face. We've had an opportunity to review everything. We all have some questions we're eager to ask you. But before we go down that road, maybe you'd like to just introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about you.
Well, thank you, first of all, for having me and calling me back in for this follow-up interview. It has been quite an experience. I have never gone through the public interview process before, so thanks for the experience. So where I find myself here is after about 17 years with my current company. I'm still employed, still happily employed, good career with my current employer. It's just reached a point where I'm at sort of at a crossroads where a company is in a state of reorganization globally. Everyone kind of clamoring for what roles they're going to be taking on in the future. And to be honest, it was really an opportunity for me to stop and say, what do I want to be doing as I go forward? I've been with the company for a long time. I know it very well. But is there a new opportunity? Is there a new experience out there I can take advantage of? That's where my mindset was in actually coming along on this process. And by certain circumstances, I happened to hear about the opening for the director of finance and operations, and was pretty much hooked from the moment I read the description. It sort of hit all cylinders for me in the sense that it's been a career of honing technical skills, finance skills, managerial skills, and really was a chance to kind of bring all that together in what I dub a CFO type position. The company I work for is this, you know, $8 billion behemoth of 450,000 employees, and part of my thought process is I want to be in a position to make more of a contribution personally. I want to be I want my role to have more of an impact and not be lost. And so sort of all the, you know, the stars aligned, and it was an opportunity to say this sounds like, you know, a perfect opportunity to really tap into all those skills. The skills with working with financial systems, doing financial analysis and reporting out to executives and committees and that type of thing. All the things I've been doing over the years, managing people, working with a myriad of departments and functions, and I've been doing that at specific points in my career, and I'm looking at this and saying, wow, what a great opportunity to kind of bring it all together now. And so that's the short of it is what brought me, you know, to go ahead and apply and look into this. So That's where I'm at now. I am looking for just to also have the opportunity to work for, I guess, the best way I can say it is a more socially driven process. You know, you work for a big company, you're publicly owned, you work for a shareholder per se, okay, great. But, you know, at this point in my career, I think it's a great opportunity to say there's maybe a little bit more, I don't know if the word important, but it's a little more socially driven, a little more personally satisfying to say I get to work for the betterment of education in Reading. I work for the taxpayer. I work for the school committee. There's quite a different audience than the profit-driven motive. It's the socially driven motive versus the profit. So I would say that has been the other thing, the other appeal that has really drawn me in. So.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Does anyone on the committee want to ask a question?
Well, one of the tools that we use between the town and here is the Munis system. I was wondering if you're familiar with it or how you are in learning new systems.
I'm not familiar with it, to be honest, but I have been through several cycles of implementations of financial systems where I've worked. It's they're all the same in the sense that there's certain inputs, right, and there's certain outputs you need from it. You wouldn't be using Munis if it didn't meet the basic needs of the town, of the school district, and we can always gripe about every financial system technology out there, but if it's meeting the needs and we're getting the most out of it, great. My computer skills are at a level at which I'm very easily adapted to learning new systems. We use pretty much state-of-the-art systems in my current company, but it wasn't always that way. We had to kind of hodgepodge together different kinds of systems, some that were old DOS-based systems and that kind of thing. So I would say my comfort level is very high with being able to pick up that pretty quickly.
Thank you, and thank you for going through this process with us. I meant to start with that. Thank you.
Mrs. Wood? Yeah, I have a question sort of along the lines of this different audience of the public, the taxpayer, the parents, and specifically town meeting. So our budgets get approved through town meeting, which is a significant forum for us at least two times a year. And so I'm just curious if you've put some thought into how you would handle that town meeting, sort of being, you know, the person on the hook at the podium, and you've got 224 or so people sort of staring at you, and when things, and, you know, asking questions, asking hard questions, and although we're supposed to stay away from being personal, quite often it isn't always, and sort of coming at you, and just wondering how you, what skill set you bring to bear in that kind of a situation?
I think the first skill set is being prepared and knowing your material. There's a lot of confidence that's going to come with making sure you own the material you're bringing and talking about. You're not always going to have all the answers to all the questions, but in that preparation process, you also anticipate the tough questions. You anticipate who the audience is going to be. That's a skill I feel like I've honed over the years. That's the first thing, sort of the first thing in my process is who's going to be listening to this? What is their level of understanding? What's their skin in the game, so to say? And what is it? What can I anticipate that they're going to, you know, want to hear in the sense of explanations, what level of clarity, that kind of thing. So I think that preparation and that familiarity with your material is going to take you a long way. If you've done that and still aren't able to answer the question, then it's a little bit of a stop sign at that point. The last thing I would want to do is speak out of turn or without all of the facts. So I think it's important that if it does get to that point where you are not able to move forward with the conversation, let me follow up and get back to you. Let me get the correct answer, and then make sure you actually do the follow up. That's the most important, and that's what's going to gain the credibility for myself, for the school committee. Is can we get back to the person in a timely way with the information they need? So that would be my approach.
Mrs. Joyce. So I think the biggest challenge here for candidates coming from the private sector moving into the public sector is the limited resources that we have. You come from a very successful company, very financially successful company, and so in order for you to be successful, you have a lot of tools. Here in this position, you're not gonna, you have very limited resources in, you know, personnel and money and everything. So how can you adapt to this kind of an environment, and what support do you think you'll need to be successful?
Personally, I find a tremendous amount of enjoyment and excitement thinking about how can, apart from the question of what do we have to work with, is how are we getting the most out of what we do have. I am not naive to know the restrictions that a school district works under, and the financial, the limitation and restriction on the financial resources. So then it just becomes a question: are we, you know, are we getting the biggest bang for our buck? And that, to be honest, is very appealing to me. That state of mind that we have some great technology where I work. We have some great resources. In some instances, that means nothing. That doesn't get you always to where you want to go. So that in itself is always not the answer. Is not always the answer to being successful. So there's a certain challenge to working within the parameters set forth for the school district, and to be honest, it's very appealing to me.
Thank you.
Sure. Sort of two questions tied together. Where do you see yourself in 5 years, and then what sets you apart, do you think, from our other candidates?
I would say where I would like to see myself is sort of what I was leading in with, is I just want to be able to feel like I'm making a more personal contribution. I want to sort of be able to see that the work I'm putting in, the effort I'm making is having some kind of positive, hopefully, positive, tangible impact. And that's hard in this job, right? We don't always have, you know, yes, we have the numbers, we have stats, we have test scores, we have, you know, but some of it is touchy-feely. You don't always get the concrete feedback of, am I doing a good job or not? Well, so you don't always have that answer 100%, but when you take all the evidence together, you can get a sense for whether you're having a positive impact. Do you get along well with people? Do you get things done on time? Are you answering or anticipating questions as they come up? All of that is very important, and so it's important to me to know that I'm contributing to that. So, you know, what are the ways we can measure? Are we getting the job done, you know, in Reading? Are we getting the job done for the students, for their parents, for the town, for the residents, on and on and on? And I want to feel like I'm in a position to really impact that in a favorable way. I think what sets me apart is this kind of convergence of technical skills. You have to have the foundation. You have to know the finance part of it, obviously, but it's also the soft skills, I call them, the people skills, the ability to cooperate, to influence when necessary, to make decisions, to collaborate and ask for opinions, but you know, when it's necessary, get to the point where you have to make a decision. Another thing is I don't, it's not enough for me to just be an attendee, either in the office or in a meeting. It's important to come to the table with ideas, with suggestions, with something to offer. We're sort of all in the same boat. No one has all the answers to all the questions that are going to come up, but hey, here's some ideas. Here's what I thought about. Here's what I spent some time doing. So that's important to me. So it's those hard technical skills combined with the soft skills that I think have made me successful in the past and be able to kind of walk those landmines of personalities, and you're working with a lot of different functions and departments, and everyone's got their own priorities and their own their own things they think are important, and so it's being respectful of people's time and yet, you know, getting your job done at the same time. So it's the awareness of all of that, I think, I would say for myself, is what I bring and could navigate that pretty easily at this point.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Mr. Robinson. Maybe this might overlap a little with Dr. Nyan's question, but you mentioned in your early on in your introduction that you were looking to be a CFO, or and that's kind of what this is. And to me, a CFO deals with the customer. I mean, the accounting manager, the controller, they don't. The CFO has to know the business and deal. So our customers are taxpayers, and how do you, I mean, are you comfortable presenting and defending and, you know, supporting the superintendent in that role, because it's not an internal
right
position. It's more, it's external too.
I would say, and I don't mean this to sound glib or in any way, but I would make sure I was comfortable, mm-hmm. to be honest. The last thing I want to do personally is sit in a public meeting or across from a public customer and not be prepared. So nor would I want the superintendent not to be prepared, or you to be armed with the information you need to face that same customer. So it's again kind of back to my point of it's not just being an observer, it's coming to the table prepared as best you can. It's never going to be 100%, but we all here have the same customers, and I wouldn't want any of us to be in a position where we haven't been armed with the resources or the information that we need, and to the extent I could contribute to that and make sure, you know, mitigate that is the appeal, is the appeal here. And on a scale, on a scale that really appeals to me as well. I'll be quite honest and say I really don't have aspirations to be the CFO of an $8 billion company and all that comes with that. In this setting, with this kind of customer and, you know, this kind of end goal, absolutely. In this kind of scale, where there's a lot of opportunity to make a personal difference is definitely what draws me.
Can I just ask one other? I'm just curious. Just had a question about Sodexo. That's a food service.
Yes. Yes.
Now, are there labor unions there, or is that are the employees?
Some of our accounts do have unionized labor.
You get involved in that, or have you?
I have not been involved in. We've got, as you would expect, an entire army of legal folks and contract folks and that kind of thing. So I have not been directly involved in union negotiations. To the extent that it touches finance, Yes, on the periphery, to be honest, to the extent where it impacts costs, benefits, these kinds of things. Yes, I have been brought in, but not in any kind of negotiation aspect.
Thank you. That's interesting.
I had a question. I don't know if you had the opportunity to see our annual budget.
I did.
Okay.
I did. All 155 pages of it.
I hope you enjoyed every page.
Yes.
So one of the, it's really one of the more public ways that the school committee works with this role is the development of that budget and ultimately, as Mrs. Webb said, the presentation of that budget at town meeting, who will ultimately determine what money gets spent on public education in the community. So my question to you is, looking at it from your perspective, did you see anything that you thought, oh boy, this is great, I would definitely keep this? And conversely, did you see anything that you went, boy, if I were taking over this document, I might make some changes? So what was your perspective on the document?
I thought the document was, as a first-time reader of it, I thought it was an incredible, it was not only a document proposing the budget, but it was also at the same time a resource document. It had a lot of background information. For me personally, as a first-time reader of it, wow, great. Oh, now I know what this means. Oh, now I know what the process is here. It's, you know, it's got a 50-page appendix in the back, and great resource document, great point in time reference document. So it wasn't just numbers. It wasn't just here's the expenses we propose. It's statistics. It's all of the things that are backing up the numbers, which was what really caught my eye and impressed me about the document. And so, you know, I tend to, as a first-time reader, the only thing I would say is as I was looking for a little bit more of a summary. Now, everyone here lives and breathes this every year, so you're intimately familiar with the document. You know, the only thing that came to mind is a question of are we adequately putting this in a one pager for our public readers or that kind of thing. I would be hesitant to say there's anything I would change about it right now without knowing any better. And how the information's used and what you're actually looking at and what resonates with you as you're reviewing the document. So I think part of the answer to that question is I would want to go to you as part of that, the answer to that, and say, what do you think is working? You know, because again, you know, you guys are also on the firing line, so to speak, for what's in there and proving adequately to decision makers why certain funds are being requested, et cetera, et cetera. So no easy answer to the question other than I was quite impressed by it, and I realize why, like in most companies, the budget process is a 7-month process, right? So
<Not quick. laughs> thank you for that answer. 30 minutes
okay.
is up, right. Believe it or not. But before we let you go, was there anyone in the committee who had a burning just a question you just have to have Joseph answer before we let him? No? All set?
I'm good.
Thank you so
Thank
much
you.
For all of the time that you've dedicated and your interest in this position.
Thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Kimberly.
Hi, how are you?
I'm very well. Thank you for being here with us this evening and for your continued participation in a process that is very intense.
Yes,
and
it
very
is.
Thorough.
And so you're sitting in the same seats that you were sitting in when I watched you last night on television.
We don't switch.
Try to keep it consistent.
I decided to watch it. I was a little embarrassed that I hadn't been seeing I'm a resident, Reading resident, but, you know, life happens. That's why I'm here now. Try to change that.
Well, I'm Jean, and my colleagues are Dr. Gary Nyan, Julie Joyce, Chuck Robinson, Linda Snow-Doxer, and Elaine Webb. And we all have had the opportunity to look at your resume and your mm-hmm. background and your experience, mm-hmm. and we're very eager to ask you some questions.
Sure.
But before we do that, mm-hmm. maybe you might want to just tell us a little bit about yourself
okay.
And your interest in this position.
Mm-hmm. I am born and raised in Reading, lived here my entire life, besides going off to college. And I went to Pearl Street for a year, Killam, Coolidge High School. I came back to this town because of the excellent school system that you have. I feel like some people like to send their kids to private school, which is fine, but I just figured for the value of my tax dollar that it's a great school system. I have actually worked at Oxford for 22 years, which is a little unusual, I realize, in this day and age. Mostly I can say it's because of my children and the flexibility that they gave me along my career. When my son was born, I went to my boss and asked for Mondays off, and he gave me Mondays off for the first 5 years until we were purchased by the on assignment public company. So it really was that kind of give and take. He was very flexible. He himself had younger children. And we go to their baseball games and whatnot. And it was kind of that respect that he had for me that I had. So it was like the give and take. Well, he would let me do that. I would want to do more back for him. So it's kind of like that trade-off. So he pretty much instilled that in me as a manager as well, that if you treat your employees with respect, you get respect back. So. Lately, obviously, after 22 years of being someplace, sometimes you get a little, you know, just going through the motions, and I was reading the superintendent's blog because kids in the district, and I saw the director of finance. Oh, wait a minute. And I just clicked on it and started linking around and said, I could do that. And I've always wanted to get involved with the school. I was the treasurer for Killam PTO for 3 years. I'm just passing the torch right now, actually. It definitely gave me some insight on behind the scenes of what goes on in the school. Watching Kathy and Priscilla, kind of her right hand, you know, run that school and seeing all of what they have to deal with every day, it was definitely eye-opening. So I just feel like it just seems for me this, like the stars aligned, and it's like the perfect opportunity for me now really to get to take my finance background and to really get into the school, because I do see that we're in a little bit of a, you know, with the override and the shortfalls, the $2 million shortfall, and what are we going to do for the next, you know, 5 to 10 years. But I think we're definitely at a point, we're at a turning point that we have to figure out what we're going to do. So I would love to be involved and to help, and I would hope you would be open to suggestions from, you know, outside of a school district, although I might not know how things work. You might have to tell me, well, that's not quite how we do things here, but, or, well, we'll try it, but, you know, if you would be open to suggestions or comments or ideas, you know. That's it. Pretty much.
Well, thank you so much. That was a great intro. I've opened it up to the committee. Are there any questions that you'd like to start with? Mr. Nyan?
So,
Dr. Nyan, sorry.
So, Kim, where do you see yourself 5 years from now? And then what sets you apart from our other candidates, do you think?
Where do I see myself 5 years from now? Well, with my track record of 22 years, probably still here. And what would set me apart from these candidates would be that I am from Reading. So I'm very familiar with the schools, the town, the past history, and I would be raising my own taxes, so I'm gonna have to go home to my husband. Why do we need this money? So, you know, it would be, if I can explain it to him why we need it, then I should be explaining it to everyone else why. Why we.
Great, thank you. Mrs. Webb?
In terms of this job, and if you're familiar with how Priscilla and Kathy work at the local level, all of our administrators work really quite tirelessly. And so that often includes, especially in these roles, during the 7 month or so budget season, a lot of public meetings, evenings, weekends, early mornings, late nights. We get emails from the superintendent at 6:24 and 11:44 p.m. So it's quite a range, and the demands are pretty significant. So maybe you could just sort of talk about how that compares to your current role, a little bit more about your current role, and how you see yourself really meeting those kinds of demands.
Mm-hmm. That's actually a pretty easy one. Back in October, I went out to California for my parent company, and I took back the accounting of two divisions for that total $130 million on top of the $400 million that our division already made. So needless to say, it was not a perfect transition, and I've gotten many emails from my direct boss in Boston and from California. Now, California's 3 hours the other way, so I get emails 9 o'clock. It's only 6 o'clock out there, so I will get emails all night. Just a couple weeks ago, trying to close the quarter. We only have 8 days to close the quarter, get our numbers up to California. So I was emailing, texting my boss at 11 o'clock. So I'm definitely used to that. For the most part, though, the same thing is it's that, if I say my son has a baseball game, 5:45, so I'll leave, go to the baseball game, and then I'll log back on and check my emails while I'm there, make sure there's nothing urgent that I have to address right away. Oh, can it wait? So there's the balance that you do have to find. But I am definitely no stranger to long hours. Mm-hmm.
Mrs. Joyce.
A little bit along those same lines, when you're going from the private sector to the public sector, and especially coming here now to the town of Reading, where we, as you know, we have our financial challenges and we have limited resources. And working in the private sector, you definitely have a lot more resources. So how do you think you would adapt to working on the public side and what with limited resources, and what kind of support do you think you would need to be successful in the role?
I think I would need, Dr. Doherty already explained that there would be some type of mentor that would be assigned. So I would just need someone to kind of just show me the ropes and kind of just explain. I would try to absorb as much knowledge as I possibly can about the school system and how it works, and just gain knowledge, because knowledge is knowing and understanding how things work. Is really important. I run a GL group and an AP group, but I also understand the payroll section. I understand the billing. I understand how that all rolls together. All the information comes together. So it's very important to understand all aspects. You have to understand HR and even the facilities and how it relates, and then everything has a finance aspect to it as well, how that all rolls to one. So I would be very interested in making sure that I understood and talking to people and trying to gather as much information as I could to understand it. And then once I start understanding it, start throwing out ideas, suggestions, compiling data, information, just trying to understand what my role is and what my expectation would be besides just the numbers part of it as well.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here and going through this long process, and thank you for being treasurer at Killam. One of my questions is, the town and the schools rely on Munis to process the budget and keep track of our numbers and our funds. Are you familiar with Munis, and how are you in terms of, if you're not getting up to speed on a new program?
I'm not familiar with it at all, but I'm a quick learner. I have no doubt that I'll be able to figure it out. Probably just have someone help me a little bit. We have PeopleSoft financials at Oxford. I've been involved in several implementations of upgrades, and same thing, this is where you have to understand how all of the inputs come in, so you can understand how you build a system, and if you want to change a system, modify a system, if you change this, what will you break down the line? So I'm not worried about it. I'm sure most accounting software is pretty much the same, just looks a little different. So
yes, Mr. Robinson.
Thank you for coming. Mm-hmm. With a lot of what you've done is preparing the information to give to the chief financial officer. Is Oxford a publicly traded company? Or?
On assignment owns Oxford, and on assignment is a publicly traded company.
Yeah. So. Mm-hmm. So they have to present. Are you? So this position's that level now. That's going to be not only preparing the information but also selling it to the taxpayers. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about your comfort level of presenting?
I don't present much. Prior to this, I was a little nervous about it. This has definitely given me some confidence in front of all these people. But when you're very comfortable with what you know, then talking about it usually isn't a problem. Mm-hmm. So when I'm in front of my group, my team, and I have them in front of me and we're talking, or if I'm instructing another group but teaching them what I know or telling them what I know, then generally I'm very comfortable in that situation. So I don't see it as a problem.
Thank you.
I have a question. I'm imagining as a PTO treasurer, you've perhaps looked at the school budget, the annual school mm-hmm. budget. So it's one of the major ways that you work with the school committee mm-hmm. in this role is to create that document. When you looked at it, did you have any instincts about aspects of it that you thought were very solid that you would definitely keep? Or conversely, you know, anything you looked at and said, boy, if I were taking over this kind of a budget, I might make the following changes. So mm-hmm. what was your reaction to the annual budget document?
The document itself, I thought was long. I didn't realize it was several pages. There's a lot of information in it. Honestly, wished I had read it sooner. But I think that's probably that might also be what's somewhat intimidating from someone maybe who, everyone who lives in Reading should read that, but maybe they just don't feel like they could. So maybe you could cut it up a little bit and do, like I saw in the 2018 budget preparation, there was prettier slides and things that were quick eye-catching things. So I do understand you have to have complete transparency. So maybe in the beginning, putting some bigger like key components so that people can quickly understand it, and then putting the details maybe in the back or something. So those people who do want the complete transparency and they want to see every single number could understand. They could go over there and they could look for everything. But most people could understand very quickly, because we're going to have to, from what the numbers that I was looking, there's pretty much you're going to have to go for the override. And it's not just for next year, it would be what is our plan? What is the plan going to be? As at some point, Killam needs a remodel as well. So what is your 5 to 10 year plan? So I think you need to present that to the community so that they thoroughly understand that if you don't do this, this is what will happen down the road. And I was even looking at some data earlier at about the per pupil spending and looking at how is Burlington up. So how are they number one? Well, the obvious is the commercial space. It's 50% of their budget. So it's an interesting piece because ours is mostly from property, personal property tax. So how do we fit and how do we figure out what to do with the resources that we have? And you're going to have to get the public on board with understanding that if we don't take these actions, that the school system won't be the school system that I wanted it to be when I moved into this town. So, you know, it would be very challenging. But.
Thank you. Any follow-up questions? Give me a moment. I'll ask. I think I got one more. We have a little bit of time. What would be your transition plan? What do your first 6 to 12 months look like in a role like this? Especially as it's been asked in a couple of questions. This is a huge transition from 22 years at a private sector company to a public sector job. So how would you make that transition?
I would want to sit down and meet with as many people as possible for all spectrums of from managers to just to the people actually do the work, the accountants, the HR, so you get the both sides. The people who do the work, they're the ones who can usually tell you very quickly where they see problems. Just to gain as much knowledge as I could about how things run. And then after that, I should start to kind of be able to recognize, well, where could we do this, could we do that? I think that would be my main objective, just to learn as much as I can. I've been reading the budget, scouring websites, Burlington website, trying to figure out what are they doing, you know, different, and what's the difference. And it's the commercial revenue that they have. But
thank you so much. All set? Well, thank you again so much for taking so much time. I know it's been a thorough process. We really do appreciate it.
I just want to take the opportunity to thank you for letting me come in and just tell you that I really would be really excited to have this opportunity, and it's going to have to be something that we'll be looking at anyways, from my point of view, from what is the town going to do going forward? What are they going to do about Killam? My daughter's still at Killam. So just something that I would really enjoy doing, and is a different something different in my life, so it would be just exciting to do something.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to extend my gratitude to the search committee. What a really excellent job you did, and particularly for representing us and Dr. Doherty. I mean, you put a lot of work in. So that was very exciting to meet three such qualified candidates. I think from a process perspective, we will be discussing on Wednesday evening. Is that correct? So we don't have it on our agenda this evening to discuss. So I'd encourage the committee to spend the next 48 hours giving some thought to what you heard. If you have any specific follow-up questions, I'm very specific.
Yes.
I'm sure Dr. Doherty could answer if you had a specific
question. We are in the process of checking the references.
Absolutely.
Of all three.
But we should all come Wednesday evening prepared to discuss the particular strengths we saw, married to what we expect from the position, and ready to weigh in on who we think is the right choice for right now. So thank you, Dr. Doherty. I think we're going to move right along to a first reading of a policy. Dr. Doherty, could you provide us with a little bit of we kind of went through a bit of this last week, so I assume it's
yes.
the same story.
Yes. So I am, if it's okay, I'm going to walk you through a little bit of it, because there are two different types of changes here. The first type of changes are changes that were recommended as part of the new opioid law. And that is really the first page of the policy, JICH. The rest of the changes are changes that have been recommended that through several meetings that I've had over the year with Adam Bacher, high school principal, Tom Zaya, assistant principal for athletics, school resource officer Malulo, and Erica McNamara. A lot of this is based on, we've now had this policy in place, I believe, for 4 or 5 years. and some changes that we're recommending that are made to the chemical health policy. So there's really two parts. The first page, for the most part, are changes that are being recommended out of the opioid law. The remaining piece, which is JICHR, those are changes that are being recommended by administration and staff. Okay. So if you want, I can walk you through the major pieces.
Yeah, why don't we do that?
Before you start the reading?
Yeah.
Okay. So on the first page, the very first paragraph is something that we felt we should put into the policy, which really talks about, you know, why do we have this policy in place? So that's more of a Reading Public School piece. The rest of the first page comes right from the MASC recommendations for the opioid law. So that really is the JICH. And then moving on to JICHR, there are several changes that were made to include nicotine now as part of the policy, where that was not before, for obvious reasons. Now nicotine has become separate from tobacco when vaping occurs. In the use
I'm sorry,
of
where were you? Where are you right now?
It throughout the whole policy, nicotine is inserted in several places with tobacko.
JICHR.
And JICHR.
Right, I see. I'm sorry.
Sorry. So moving on to the second page of JICHR.
John, can I?
Yes.
Question. Is that right?
Oh yeah.
So, but on the first page, I know that maybe it's because the language comes from MASC, right? The second paragraph, it talks about, you know, tobacco products versus the nicotine. But is that just simply because this language comes from, this was the language recommended by the MASC?
You're talking about JICH?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so it doesn't, but in JICHR, we've basically added that sort of nicotine delivery, the vape,
correct,
some of the other things. Okay.
Correct.
Can I ask a follow-up question to that? Would there be any harm in that second paragraph of JICH basically doing what you did in the other policy, which is everywhere it says, you know, tobacco and or nicotine, any tobacco and or nicotine product? Yeah, the school committee prohibits the use or consumption of alcohol, comma, tobacco or nicotine products.
We can do that.
I think that the consistency is,
sort of,
yeah, I think the consistency is a good idea, unless you saw a reason why we shouldn't.
Yeah.
I like that.
On the second page, want me to continue?
Yes, please. Yeah.
On the second page of JICHR, you'll see a paragraph, red line paragraph, second paragraph, in addition, students in possession or deemed to be under the influence need to participate in a education program. This is something we've been doing, but now we want to put it in writing. So this is for any student, whether they're in athletics or extracurricular. And we have been including them as part of the education program. We now want to put it in writing and codifying it, because it wasn't specifically stated in the policy. And then the same for the next piece. It really is saying the same thing under possession and of or use of alcohol and drugs regulations.
Mr.
Robinson?
I have a question. So on that paragraph where you just referenced, it says the last sentence, the content, nature, and length of the program will be determined by the building principal and based upon the nature of the So what happens if something happens on the weekend? Is that still going to be a building principal that's going to?
If it is in school or at a school-sponsored event.
I'm talking about if they show up at somebody's house and there's kids drinking or whatever, and that's
we don't have the legal jurisdiction. It would be only for people that for students that are not involved in athletics or extracurricular activities we're talking about now.
Okay.
We don't have the legal means to do that.
Right. I just.
But if it's at a school-sponsored event on a weekend, yes, we do.
I just clarify, so the athletics piece must be coming later in
it
this.
It is.
Okay.
It is.
Just picture. So this is that non, and it's something we had been doing, but like you said, it hadn't been really part of the policy.
It wasn't in the policy.
Okay.
But early on, when we started doing the education piece for athletics and extracurricular, we realized that we should also be doing it for students.
It's to establish equity.
Correct, right, correct.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I have a question on the language. Okay. Was there a reason that the word need on, it says, while in school or at a school-sponsored event will need to participate in and complete, the choice of the word need as opposed to be required to? I almost lean towards the more emphatic, the stronger wording than need, because it doesn't, it's stronger wording.
I believe we were trying to mirror the MIA language for athletics. I may be wrong, but I believe that's why we used the word need.
Instead of like be required.
We were trying to keep the language parallel.
Okay.
Yeah.
You can keep going.
Yeah. Sorry.
Moving on to the next page, most of the changes here. Oh, there is one change in the second bullet on that page. And again, it talks about limiting, it's denying of other privileges, for example, removal of parking pass, if someone is in violation of possession of alcohol or other drugs. So we wanted to include that, and that piece is in there. It's the second bullet.
Okay.
It says, or deny other privileges, i.e. removal of parking pass.
And I have a question. So what does that mean? Does that mean they can't drive to school or they can't park in the, they can, what have they parked up on Oakland Road?
They can't use the school parking lot. And that was just an example. It's not,
oh, okay.
It's not necessarily what would happen, but.
Is that something that has happened in practice or more just an option you want to have available?
It's an option that we want the administration to have available.
But would it prevent them from driving to school? Or like Chuck was saying, could they
park? Again, it was, it, that is an example. It's not necessarily the only thing that could happen. They could not park on school property. They would not be given a parking pass.
But they could park on Oakland Road.
If you want, I can remove in the parentheses the example.
Well, I think the reason why, is there any, I'm sorry, Gina.
No, it's okay.
The reason why I think three of us have asked it, is there any teeth in it? I mean, if you're saying you can't park in the parking lot, but you can park, what's the point of taking the, they just park? And furthermore, I don't know whether I want a student using the excuse I couldn't drive to school, so I couldn't get there either. So maybe that's a topic for another discussion, but
we can certainly remove the example. We do want to give the administration the opportunity to deny other privileges that students may have. It could be senior privileges, it could be other things.
Right. So is the idea then to sort of know with any individual student what the lever is? What are the ways that you can ensure that they change this unhealthy behavior? Is that sort of the intent?
Yes.
And so what might be an important privilege for one child might be something different for another.
Correct.
All right. Just wanted to try to understand the intent.
But we can certainly remove the example.
I also read that it made sense to me because I have come through the parking lot and seen smoke coming out windows. And if that's the place where the infraction is happening, it makes perfect sense to me that they would lose that opportunity to have that place to break the rules. So I took it as an example.
It is, again, but as three members stated, it's not stopping them from parking on Oakland Road or Birch Meadow Drive.
One thing I'd like to caution is, as much as I think this, it's good to have some flexibility in terms of how you handle the circumstance, there also needs to be consistency or it'll potentially come back in you. That way you could see personal experience working with rules like this similar in other districts.
Okay. Yep.
Well, I agree with that I think maybe just a better example, because I see Linda's point too. I mean, it's addressing a privilege that is a consistent consequence and relevant to the student. So obviously you can't take a senior privilege away from a freshman. So, and I do think that, but I think that it's important, there's a real balance between, you know, prescribing everything, but then allowing to have enough flexibility to address really the personal situation at hand, and always the goal in mind. The end goal here is to turn student behavior around, and you want to have that opportunity. So,
to Mr. Nyan's point, has this gone through legal review, or will it, or what's the process for that?
We are allowed legally to remove anything that is not tied into the educational needs of the student. So extracurricular activities, privileges like a parking pass, those are all things that we're not required to provide.
Okay. Good. Thank you. Dr. Doxson.
Also, to Dr. Nyan's point, one of the things when I was reading through these policies related to who was making the decision, and I was leaning towards having more than one person involved. In some places it says the building principal, in another place it says, later on it says the athletic director. And my feeling was, having been listening to some of the criticisms, I feel like it might be better not to have just the athletic director making the decision about an infraction, but that if two people are involved, that stands up better in terms of the repercussions and following through on the policy.
I'd agree. It does put a lot of pressure on the athletic director. Everything sort of goes back to him, like, okay, this is his decision, whereas if there's, you know, a group decision, I'd also suggest that the resource officer could be involved too.
Actually, the resource officer cannot.
Oh, really? Cannot?
Yeah. Not legally. Under Massachusetts General Law, it's the building principal.
I think I'd like to hold on. I think it's an interesting point, but maybe we should let Dr. Doherty get through.
But if I could just answer that, under Massachusetts General Law, it is the building principal that gives out the consequences. So, you know, Mr. Barker could certainly speak more to it. He'll be here Wednesday night. But it is ultimately him. Now, they can appeal to him, which is stated in the process, and in some cases it can be appealed to the superintendent. But under the law, it is the building principal.
I'm hearing the concern that's raised, but I could also see another sort of flip side of that is having one person responsible makes it a bit of an easier process. If there are two people responsible, then the person has some leeway to try to negotiate different personalities. There could be a benefit to know this is the principal's authority, and it, perhaps that's the intent of Mass General Law. But, Mrs. Webb.
Yeah, I just want to say that I think, you know, maybe this is, we'll get more clarity when Adam is here, but I think we have to be really, really careful of this, because you add cost, you add time, and we have neither. And so we have to make sure that I think the people who are executing this, if it's, you know, whether it's the athletic director or the building principal, are well trained, are rigorous in their execution of the process. And I believe that we've had challenges in the past that have gone to any like civil liberties, we've never had, and there's never been any issue here with this policy.
Because it's case law that backs up the things that we're doing in this policy.
So I would, you know, unless there's a lot of data that says this doesn't work effectively right now, I wouldn't.
We're not proposing changes to the way the decision-making process is going on. That's not part of the changes that we're making.
No, I know that's what sort of the discussion was, and I'm just saying I wouldn't propose that right at this juncture unless someone was showing me data to say that there's an aspect of this decision-making process that isn't working well. I think it's very, you know, important that our administrators are, you know, well trained and well aware of how important their role is in being sort of fair and consistent and, you know, considering the facts and executing the consequences. They know that if they don't do it well, it's going to come back. So I think, I'm just saying, I know we're having this sort of offline dialogue. I think there's a lot that would be a lot longer dialogue if we were going to change the decision-making process.
And as long as we're having an offline conversation, I'm going to throw it back to you. But as we were, as I was reading these revisions to these policies and being reminded of the existence of these policies, I was reminded of the last ARCASA Youth Risk Behavior Survey presentation we got, where she was able to specifically point to a downward trend in some particularly problematic substance abuse issues we've had in our community. And she was able to pinpoint not just this policy, but this policy was part of some general policy changes that were made at a certain point in time. So well, to your point about data and evidence, we have evidence that this policy has been working, which I think is, I was very happy to remember and an important thing to consider.
I'd also add to that, that to be critical of that statement, but you really have to see it over a period of time. Just be, if it's just happened within 1 year, then that could just be a, you know, aberration.
We actually have data over the last 5 years that's showing
showed,
that down
yeah,
the trend.
It was over several years. It was impressive.
I'm not saying that didn't, but I'm just saying that that needs to be, you know, consideration. And in some situations, even 5 years isn't considered,
you want to see it sustained.
Yeah, 10-year separate cycle.
All right, thank you, Dr. Daugherty, for that, can you if you want to keep walking us through.
Continuing on, the next piece focuses on smoking and tobacco and nicotine, so a lot of the changes that you see are adding the word nicotine. And the same with the next page. These are all pieces that were already existing in the policy. We're just adding nicotine. Moving on to the next page, chemical health regulations for high school athletics and extracurricular activities. We have updated the list to include vaping pens and other tools and other drugs based on what has changed in the last few years. And I think that's it on that page. And then the next page, the only thing we changed was you can see the word confirms instead of finds, and that's consistent with MIAA. They had confirms in there. I think at one time they had fines, and that's what we were using, and then they must have changed their wording so that it's just to stay consistent with MIAA, because a lot of this. And I probably should have said this at the beginning because I think there's just some misunderstanding in the community. A lot of this policy is MIAA policy.
Of this part of this policy.
Correct.
Yeah.
This is not the Reading Public Schools coming up with this policy. This is the MIAA. So even if this policy disappeared tomorrow, we would still be using MIAA regulations, which is very consistent with this. The next page, again, we just changed the confirms. And then the next page under other, I don't see any. Oh, we just made a couple word changes and used fall sport instead of football. We had received some complaints in the past that we were picking on a particular sport, so. And then the next page, one change that we put in place, because it was creating an issue, is you see number five, if a student loses multiple leadership positions and or team captain positions as a result of a chemical health violation, they may appeal to the high school principal for restoration of other leadership captain positions beyond the first position. An exception to this is National Honor Society, which has its own set of rules. But you may have a student that has multiple leadership positions, and then under this policy right now, they would lose them all. And so it's a balance, you know, in how you want to approach that. So the high school administration felt that this is something that should be put in there, that it is an appeal process that the family could go to the principal and to get a position reinstated beyond the first one. And then on number seven, there's been some timelines added. The current policy does not have a timeline at all added to it. So this is a 7-day We were finding at times that a violation wouldn't be filed until just before maybe the season started of that particular person, and it was creating some problems.
I just have a quick question.
Did you get us through everything you wanted to?
I believe that was it.
All right, Mrs. Webb, Mrs. Joyce had a question earlier, and I asked her to just wait till Dr. Doherty was finished. Do you have that question ready?
I do. Just going back to the penalties for nicotine and tobacco and nicotine use, I noticed in the first violation there's a payment of $75 fee, or in lieu of fine, 6 hours of community service. The community service component isn't in any of the second or third or fourth offenses.
This is right from the Board of Health.
I know.
So that's...
Can I ask what page this is on?
It's penalties for tobacco / nicotine use.
Okay.
And then there are four bullets with sub-bullets.
Mm-hmm. I just thought it was interesting that it's only in the first infraction and not again.
The history behind this is that this is a Board of Health regulation.
Right.
And our administrators have to actually get deputized to give tickets. So this is really under the Board of Health.
Okay. Well, honestly, I'd rather have the ticket go away and have the community service. I'm really asking about the community service aspect of it. It's only listed in the first infraction, and it's only if you don't pay the fine.
Right. What I'm saying, this is under Massachusetts. This, what you see right here, is under Massachusetts general law. This is not Reading Public Schools.
We can't change that.
We can't change that
without being in conflict with.
You could. You could add it. I don't think you could subtract it.
Oh yeah, no. I think I'd like to see it subtracted. I know we can't do that, but I'd like to see it added.
The community service piece.
Yeah.
Yes. Can we understand the rationale though, why it wasn't in the others first? Because I think part of it is. You know, you get the opportunity to mitigate the financial damage with the community service, and that seems appropriate. But if you go ahead and you do another violation, it's funny that it's the third offense is the same amount of money, by the way, but you lose. It seems like logical to me that the more violations you have, you lose opportunities to avoid the financial impact. I mean, and I also wonder. Who tracks the community service?
It would be the high school.
So the high school administrator, staff member, whatever. This is Mass General Law under public health law, and we have school administrators that have to track that somebody did 6 hours of community service.
I completely understand that, but it's easy to pay a fine and then create another offense. I think if you're doing community service, it might make you think about it a little bit more. That's all. To me, it's a better penalty.
I think it might fall a bit outside the scope of this discussion if we're being consistent with Mass General law. I actually agree with you on community service. I agree with you, but I think it's outside the scope of what we're trying to do. But it's a good point.
Yeah. I have a question on that. And so with our policies, we start with the bottom line is the Mass law.
Mm-hmm.
But can't we, we have changed the law, we've added to the law, we've added to the MIAA policy with the education program because we care very much about the education of our students, not just the censoring and discipline of them. So now our athletic policy requires the kids go through a training as well as what MIAA requires. MIAA doesn't require the training unless they've changed that. And so my feeling is that the law is the bottom line, but sometimes we do go beyond the law. And so I actually was on the same page as Julian when I was going through this. I was thinking, well, the fine's the same, but maybe they need the community service as well. Now, I also hear Mrs. Webb, and I've heard about how difficult it is to enforce the education programs and the community service piece. So it might be something I'd love to happen that's not actually possible to administer. But I like the idea of having, in addition to the Mass law, the community service. Just might not be practical, but
yeah, I think it's important to remind ourselves that the reason we're even looking at this is the state has passed an opioid law, and we want our policies to be consistent with that. If there's an appetite on the committee for a further review of this, that's a much broader discussion, and I wouldn't want to tonight say, oh, while we're looking at this, I had a gut reaction, and so now let's start changing things. That's a really big discussion about resources, about unintended consequences, about general consensus on the committee. So I do think that it's outside the scope of what we're doing tonight. Not to say it isn't a good discussion worth having, but we could probably do that with any of our policies. Mm-hmm. So I think I would like to focus this on making sure our policies are consistent with the new state law. And then as a second step, if there's an appetite for further review, let's have that conversation, but not this evening and Wednesday night.
When do you think we would have it, though?
Well, we can discuss putting it on the agenda at any point.
So I just want to make sure I understand. What I'm hearing is you want to add community service to the other three violations?
Well, we no.
No.
A couple of people do. We haven't had that discussion
right.
yet.
And what I'm saying is that's a big discussion.
We're not in agreement on that even.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm not adding it for Wednesday night.
No, I would not. What I'm proposing is that we make sure that our policies are aligned with state law, the new opioid law, which
right.
is, I think, what's driving these policy changes.
Well, this and the changes that the administration is recommending.
Right. So I guess I would like to keep the discussion clean to those so that we can move forward with policy changes. We need to be consistent with law. And I think the discussion of, hey, I want to look at this policy in more detail and propose changes to it. Let's have that as a future agenda item. If there's consensus on the committee that that's something we want to put time and energy to, but that's time and energy. That's not hey, since it's in front of us, let's talk about it. So can we maybe put that in the back burner for future discussion? Yes, Mrs. Webb.
I have just one clarification question on the last page we were on, number 7. It just says, must be built the hemp health violation must be filed with the building principal within 7 days of the verified violation.
Yes.
So
confirmed, right?
Yeah.
Right. Is that what you?
Well, yeah, confirmed, but I'm wondering.
Verified is when it's brought to the attention of the administration from the police. Usually it's the police department.
So when, a verified violation is when the violation is brought to the administration.
Correct.
From. Generally, the police department?
Well, yes. I mean, that's usually where we
okay.
get it, the information.
I was just wondering what that, the definition of the verified violation
right.
was.
When we notify the student that they're, in violation, that's when the 7 days begins.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mr. Robinson had a question.
So I thought Elaine was asking the question. So we changed. The word to confirmed in other parts of this, wouldn't that be changed?
So it could be confirmed, sure.
Violation as
yep.
well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That'd be more consistent.
Well, it was just a first reading. But
I thought it was important, though, to walk you through it because there were a lot of changes.
I'm very glad you did. And it was clearly a fruitful discussion. I'll remind the committee and the public as well, a first reading means there will be a second meeting, which is scheduled for Wednesday night, right, Dr.
Correct.
Brody? So we will have the opportunity to further discuss this on Wednesday. I'm going to have Mr. Robinson read a motion, and then we can discuss further after that.
move to approve the first reading of revised policy JICH-alcohol, tobacco, and drug use by students prohibited in JICH-r-chemical health regulations for high school students.
Second.
Second.
Does anybody want to propose a motion to dispense with the reading of?
So moved.
Second.
Second.
All those in favor of dispensing with the first reading? 6-0, all in favor.
Roll call.
Yeah, you're here. We don't have to do roll call tonight. I will tell the public, though, for anyone who's interested, the full policy is in the packet, which is published on the website. So although we did not read the entire policy, it is available for anyone who wants to read it. Dr. Doxer, you had a question?
I was asking about what we're preparing for Wednesday night. So I have other suggestions and questions. Should we submit those?
No, you can go right on ahead.
So now.
Sure. Well, let me ask about scope. Are they kind of beyond what was recommended by Dr. Doherty?
Well, some of them are wording, and some of them are the discussion that I think was just referred to a later date.
Okay. Well, why don't you walk through them? We'll figure out which is which.
So just for clarity, on the first page of the JICHR, the last sentence of the first paragraph, it reads, if there is a conflict with these regulations and these policies or the RMHS student handbook, these regulations shall govern. And I just thought it was easier to understand if we were to say, if these regulations and policies conflict with other sources, such as the RMHS student handbook, these regulations shall govern. Just was easier to understand, but.
I have just one gut level comment on that, Dr. Doxer, is if you say something as broad as other sources, could that include Mass General Law or federal law, which wouldn't supersede our policies? Do you know what I mean? By saying the handbook, you're citing something specific that you want this policy to overrule. That's just a concern I have about saying, it's a question.
All right, I'm a little confused about where that paragraph was.
First paragraph
on the JICHR.
So it's one thing to say, you know, if this conflicts with anything that's ever in the handbook, this is our policy on this topic. We want this policy to supersede. If we say we want it to supersede all other sources, that could be beyond our authority as a school committee.
Right, and I'm fine with conflict with the RMHS student handbook. I thought, actually, I read it wrong the first time and thought that that was just one example.
Oh, okay.
So
you're okay with it as written?
It can be. I just thought it was confusing.
Oh, okay.
So according to what you just suggested, my edit would be, if these regulations and policies conflict with the RMHS student handbook, these regulations shall govern.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that?
Sure. If these regulations and policies conflict with the RMHS student handbook, these regulations shall govern. It just felt, but we
well,
can.
You have actually two things here. You have a policy and you have regulations that back up the policy. You have two different documents here. So that's why both are listed.
Right. Okay.
JICHR are the regulations, JICH is the policy.
Okay, all right, I get it.
I think that's the reason why it's written that way.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, Mr. Robinson.
Maybe a little bit off the pop, but I'm just trying to think of an instance where, I mean, if our handbook is in conflict with this, we have a bigger problem, right? I mean, shouldn't we make sure our handbooks or student handbooks are up?
Yes, but in the rare occasion that it may not have been updated,
okay.
Which I'm not saying is the case right now, but
update cycle.
Yeah, you just want to make sure that the policy supersedes what is in the handbook.
All right.
Or perhaps a person referring to an old version of the handbook and
right.
Say, well, this is
correct.
What I was looking at. I see it. I have a question on the second paragraph on this page. It says possession.
The more I think about it, that Michael Joyce put that language in when he reviewed this policy the last time. So that's why that language is in there.
It sounded like legal language.
Which is what policy is. It's legal language.
Right.
This isn't intended to be something that somebody reads. Certainly for
I'm
pleasure.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, that's okay. It was a good point. Underlined in the second paragraph, it says possession is defined in accordance with MGL. Did a particular area of MGL have to be listed, or can you just make a blanket statement like that? I'm used to seeing MGL referred to by specific.
No, I believe that's because they're all listed on the previous page.
Right here. Okay, so it just references the
list.
Okay, that's fine. It was just a question. Any other thoughts for the first reading? Oh, yes, Dr. Doxer.
I also had a suggestion. The first paragraph on JICH, the first paragraph about the Reading Public Schools, I love the addition of that. And I was thinking that it might actually be easier to read get the point across, not changing the language, but just making it bullets. So the purpose of the policy and the ensuing regulation that follow is to ensure bullet student safety, maintain second bullet, maintain compliance with MIAA. The next bullet is maintain the intent of the federal drug-free workplace policy, and the next bullet would be to provide guidance for school personnel and administrators so that in a look people see the rationale of our schools.
Any comments on that proposed edit?
Sounds like it would clarify it if Dr. Daugherty wants to break those out into bullets.
It's fine with me. If it's okay with you, Dr. Daugherty, do you see a problem? Okay, thank you. Oh, Dr. Nine.
Not to open up a complete can of worms, but the question I have pertains to the use of social media to report violations. I've seen it, heard of it in other districts where it can be. We have that 7-day rule, the violation has to occur in 7 days, but you won't necessarily know sometimes if it's a video that was sent to the athletic director of athletes partying and drinking alcohol, whatever. Does it bring any thought to that?
We are only using, and we have only used since this policy has begun, police records. Because you don't know what a picture that you receive or a video that could get edited.
Right.
You don't know when it was taken. It could have been taken 2 years ago. So we have always relied on police information,
mm-hmm.
Unless obviously an administrator is seeing it.
Right.
Firsthand themselves, we've not
okay.
used no, other.
Just,
yeah,
I think that's a good way to mm-hmm. respond to it.
What we have done when we've received information like that is we have made the parents aware of it.
That's
so that
important.
They at least they are they know.
Yeah.
Listen, we received this information. We certainly are not going to do anything about it, but we want to make you aware of it.
We're not in a position.
We're not in a position, right?
And then I've also seen it, I don't think it happens here, but I know in another district, the police department does have someone search the social media for these types of problems. We don't do that, though, don't I know of doing. So they'll see something
that,
and they'll report it to the athletic director.
The chief and I and the school resource officer have a lot of conversations about that. There's a lot of tools that exist out there. It really is a manpower issue. The other thing that we know is that you can only search social media when it's public.
Mm-hmm.
If a student makes it private, you can't search it. So even though the tools that are existing out there, they can't search private social media.
A lot of times those students will make it public. But nonetheless, I think, you know.
But it's a manpower issue also.
This district is able to have that manpower to do it. Mm-hmm.
Mr.
Robinson. Do we have, in one of the policies, I don't have them all memorized.
You don't?
your point's important, that people know that we only rely on police investigations so that we don't get criticized by or challenged by a resident because we didn't see something on social media. Is there some place we can fall back on and say, well, our policy is we only...
We don't have it stated anywhere in a policy.
I just wonder, maybe for discussion down the road, maybe that should be.
I would have to check with legal counsel on exactly how we would write something like that.
Well, recently we received something along those lines, so.
Legal counsel and also, right. I'd certainly want to bring in... our public safety personnel too, and the chief of police to get that's a big conversation.
Right.
Dr. Doxer, did you have something?
I did. I had an exclamation point put here because from years ago I remember a discussion about the challenge if someone should come forward to help and mandated reporters.
Another piece in here I forgot to mention. Thank you.
The conflict between wanting to encourage kids to come forward for help for themselves or for a friend. and then them being penalized for it. And here, this policy actually, I guess the law has been updated, and this addresses that.
No, actually, we put this in.
Where is this?
I love that.
Yeah, it's on the first page, and thank you. This is the one piece I forgot to mention.
I'd say it's the fourth paragraph of GICH.
We added this. This
it's
actually
so
came
important.
From Ms. McNamara.
Moreover, a student will not be penalized for proactively seeking assistance for a substance abuse use problem for themselves or if attempting to get assistance for a friend. Okay.
So if someone's on a team or something and they know a friend has a problem, they're not getting their friend kicked off the team for asking for help for him, which takes that deterrent, or her, sorry. My bad, sorry.
Yeah.
It takes that conflict away.
Okay.
Thank you, I forgot that piece, Ms. McNamara.
I was thrilled to see that. And then the other piece, sort of alluding back to a discussion for the future, the addition that Reading did above and beyond the law, where we require help or education programs, I was wondering about who might be a good support in terms of that, knowing how busy our principal, our building administrators are, if that might be something that the school psychologist or the Sarah Bird might be able to help in terms of enforcement and providing the appropriate program for the education program if they violated a rule, making sure that that student gets the help they need as opposed to just a generic.
That's coordinated in conjunction with our wellness department and our CASA.
That was my question.
So it's a dual role.
Okay, that's great. That's what I was hoping. Because it's not just the building administrator, it's working.
No, the building principal doesn't do the actual education piece, no.
Right, it says will be determined, though, by the building principal. You're saying it's really more broad than that.
Right.
It's the team that determines what that step is. Thank you.
Yeah.
Any other comments or questions on this policy for the first reading? Okay. We will have a second reading, so certainly look it over and have comments and questions ready for Wednesday night.
If there are things that I can address, or if you have questions, send them to me ahead of time.
That would be great. And also, I think particularly where it's wordsmithing, like a language change or typo or whatnot, we don't need to do that in public. All right, we have a motion and we have a second. Are we ready for a vote on the first reading?
Yes.
All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. So I believe we will now continue our discussions on the FY18 budget. Dr. Doherty has, based on our feedback from last week, created a document. I know you've just walked us through a policy change, but
I can walk you through a document.
Would you be willing to walk us through this? I will say while you hand it around that I appreciated your listening to the committee's thoughts and revising it accordingly. I found some of the detail in this version compelling.
Is anything changed from what you emailed?
No, this is just a paper copy.
Just pass them down. Today. Fairly early, though, today.
What's that?
She asked, when did it come? An email came today.
Early. This hour.
I was not here.
So all of the information that's in here you've seen before. In all of the meetings that we've had conversations about FY18 budget. We felt it was important to create a document that now can be publicly shared so that there's information out there on paper for discussion purposes about the rationale behind the items we've been discussing. So the document is broken up into a few different parts. The first part is the background of why this document exists, and then it goes through the six challenges that we've been discussing in as much detail as possible, supporting it with data and information that we've been discussing throughout the presentation. So it goes through, you could see challenge 1 through 6 are all listed there through the different pages. Then on page four, it then starts talking about, okay, so here are the challenges, here are the resources that are needed to address the challenges and the structural deficit. So it gives the list of 10 areas of resources needed to address the challenges, and then it breaks it down in detail what each of those areas are, the cost, and what that cost is, and what is it, personnel, is it other things, and then there's a concluding paragraph. Then there's an appendix, which throughout the document refers to different charts. So the first appendix, first chart talks about the number of teachers who have resigned, excluding retirements and resignations, over the last several years, and including up to July 21st. Number of staff supervised per administrator by school. Where we rank in per pupil expenditure for district and school instructional leadership. And then tables 4 and 5 is the cost analysis for two of our programs. One is our COMPASS program, which is for students diagnosed with severe autism, and how that compares to private day and public collaborative tuitions. And then also we looked at our learning language disability program, which is called the Bridge program, and how that compares to private day and public collaborative. So we did a one-year cost, and then we did, for language learning disabled, we did a seven-year cost, because that's approximately the amount of years if a student stayed in the program, how long they would be. And we did a 12-year cost for the students with a diagnosis with severe autism, because there are sometimes students that are there for all 12 years, and sometimes more, sometimes longer, if they're being educated till 22 years old. So those are tables 4 and 5. Those are two new charts. You have not seen those charts before, but it is something that we talked about we were going to do. And then the next table just goes in a little bit more detail about the resources and how it aligns to the district goals and the challenges, which are then described on the next page. And then table 7 is the projected budget shortfall, which is how we get the structural deficit. So certainly this can be a working document, and if you have any additional feedback, you know, I took your feedback very seriously. Obviously, I always take your feedback seriously, but I took it very seriously last Monday night when you said you wanted more details. So I think you have in front of you a detailed document that explains.
I feel like last week, I think the phrase I used was thread the needle, or if I didn't, it's one of my favorite phrases. But I think in a couple of places you really did that. And an example is number 6, additional supports for struggling students. We've alternatively called those MTSS Tier 2 supports, supports for struggling students. I think the way you've laid out, potentially it would be 4 academic tutors and 1 behavior certified behavior analyst. I would add the words potentially provide, because you want to be very careful that we allow ourselves some flexibility to address circumstances on the ground and as they emerge. But I think this gives someone a really good sense of what that money would purchase. 4 academic tutors can make a powerful difference, and 1 BCBA supporting not just students with an IEP, but beyond that. That's something people can get around. And there were a couple examples where those details were provided, so I appreciated that a lot. Any other comments, Mrs. Webb?
Just in the opening, I think there was some dialogue in reference to this at our last meeting, but the 0.7% increase, that's from the town manager for the municipal and school operating budgets. It says it's using free cash. And I just wondered, I know like the balance between having this be readable and clear and adding the detail, but I'm sort of wondering if that free cash amount, maybe this is also sort of in the back of the document here, if we could note what that free cash is, what that free cash is that this 0.7% is based on?
That's a good question. I'll have to ask the town manager. I can't remember.
Yeah, sorry.
Yes, go ahead, Mr. Robinson.
I thought we I don't think it includes any free cash.
The 0.7% does.
I thought it didn't.
The minus 0.3% does not.
So I guess we should just clarify that.
I can get that clarified.
He definitely has to clarify, because that's something that the Finance Committee would authorize, and unless he's had a meeting with them without us, then.
Mm-hmm. No, I don't think so.
Right?
Yes, I ride to work with a member of the Finance Committee. We were talking about this and sort of having the same argument about what was and what wasn't, so I don't really know, and I think we need to make it clear.
I believe at the last community forum, this was clarified. A listening session that was clarified that the 0.7% was an inclusion of free cash, and then it was a minus 0.3% with no free cash.
I don't think that the FinCom may have had a chance to go over that to the extent they want. So I think I'm just saying that should be clarified.
That's a good point.
I think it should be clarified, and it dovetails with another conversation, which I know the Selectmen and the Finance Committee and the Town Manager are having, which is what's the appropriate amount of free cash. We know what we've been using, and that's unsustainable. So there's what is built into this assumption, but then the broader conversation is what should we be planning on that's sustainable for the future? As whatever the assumption is in here, is that a sustainable number? Mm-hmm. So that's a good point. Dr. Thomas?
I really appreciate those cost analysis charts about how much it costs in district. I've gotten questions about that, in district versus out of district. And looking at the cost over time, I think it makes it very concrete and clear why it's beneficial for us to have appropriate programs in district and to enable other kids from out of district to come and pay tuition to be a part of ours. One of the things I don't see in here relates back to a discussion we had at our retreat where we were going to have a separate section about what we are not asking for right now, but will be on our plate in the coming years in terms of the Killam renovation and the full day kindergarten, and that we were going to, I thought we so, were going so to acknowledge it, but not.
It's embedded in
make
here.
Make it clear. Oh, all right, sorry.
Full day kindergarten and Killam are embedded in here, they're just not listed.
Sorry.
Is okay. That in the conclusion? No.
There's not a specific cost associated with Killam in this document, because I wouldn't even know what that cost would be.
No, of course not.
But it talks about Killam space needs.
It's embedded in the narrative.
It's embedded in the narrative, yes, in the narrative.
Okay. It's in number five.
And there is information here about full-day kindergarten also, and statistics compared to the rest of the state. It does not talk about a specific number for full-day kindergarten.
I apologize, I didn't.
It can be. I mean, I can certainly put that in, but.
I agree with that. I think it's important to acknowledge what we aren't looking to solve in the immediate future, but highlight that they're not needs that are going away. I think there's a transparency beat there. I think that's a good idea to pull that out and make it separate and highlight it. Full day K and the Killam renovation. And maybe mention, as long as we're talking about Killam, the modular classrooms. They're gonna last for a good long time, but not forever. Same with the Killam school, so those three lumped, and they're very tied together.
And the other thing I was asked was about, I love Mrs. Webb's referral to the cutting room floor. There are so many things that we're not even looking at including or trying to fund because it's just not feasible. And I don't know, and we talk about it in our budget document. So I didn't know if there was a place, just a section like that Killam, called it kindergarten, where it could just be, you know, this is not pie in the sky, this is just what we really need.
I think the thing that was just a little confusing, so number five on the first page, right, identifying long-term space needs to address these program changes incorporates these things, correct, John? And then
yes.
remaining comparable and competitive. Now, and those are just really the challenges that are then linked to the different areas 1 to 10 that we are proposing funding for, right? So the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
1 through 6 are the challenges.
Yeah.
1 through 10 of the resources needed to address the challenges.
So I think the thing that's just not, when you look at the challenges, we are addressing through either the structural deficit or these other specific items, we are addressing those challenges. Oh, I suppose 5 is in there. 5 is in there with the deficit in some manner, right? Addressing challenge 5. That has to be the high school program and probably the high school program improvement.
The chart in the back?
On page 9.
The chart in the back tells you what challenges are being addressed.
Right, I guess what's just, when you look at these challenges, when you look at the 10 items on that chart, right, we're addressing with proposed funding really all of the challenge areas, except really challenge 5, we're really not addressing except for to some extent in the structural deficit number, right? And I'm just thinking that we, maybe we need to just like set that part in a little bit stronger way, like even in the paragraph, in the narrative.
Can
so what part of 5 is addressed?
Can I make a suggestion, Mrs. Webb? Because I think you and Dr. Doxer are saying the same thing. I think what you're saying, here are the challenges that we're trying to solve with these 10 expenses. Maybe pull out number 5 and say, this is a long-term challenge that we will need to address and will require resources, but it's a separate saying. It isn't.
It isn't really in those numbers. So obviously there's something in 5, though, that may be addressed in the 2 million structural number.
I'm not sure. Certainly not full day kindergarten, which continues to be tuition based or building. I'm not sure.
Yeah, okay.
I think Dr. Doherty hears us. He can kind of think through that. Mr. Robinson?
Yeah, and I guess I don't think the 10 are fait accompli as of tonight. The 10, we were going to have a vote on that anyway. The 10 items, are you talking about the 10 items above the structural deficit of 2 million?
The 2 million and then those, right, the 9 items below, right, that this document defines.
Well, the 9 items, yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know what we had talked about that, I think, last time, whether or not we would be able to vote on that, take a vote about that tonight, or whether it was going to be Wednesday night.
We had mentioned Wednesday as a target for that.
I felt it was important to get you this tonight so you could digest it.
Right, and give some feedback.
Yep.
So, I think that one piece.
Okay, question.
Mr. Nyan.
Dr. Doherty, are these prioritized in any way, shape, or form?
No, they're not. My assumption was that there was the structural deficit and then everything else.
Right, yeah. No, I just didn't know if they were prioritized.
No.
For some reason, I thought the salary adjustment was already included in the initial, structural deficit, but that's not the case.
Some is.
Okay. All right.
That invariably comes up at every meeting. Can I?
Oh, yes.
I'm just talking for myself. So, and I appreciate you just said you didn't prioritize them, but, this is a pretty deep, very well-written, detailed document, and to me, I'm going to draw my own value judgments and my own priorities based on what I read here. So I don't need necessarily Dr. Doherty to provide that priority.
I was just curious if in fact he
did. Right? I mean, that's what you want us to do.
Yeah, I didn't want to prioritize them. I felt that the discussion I had heard in previous meetings is that really we had the structural deficit and then everything else. If the committee wants me to do that, I'll be more happy to, but I didn't get the sense you did.
I think that could be maybe a little bit more iterative in the next phase of this process, because the next phase obviously is this has to go to the Board of Selectmen, who need to weigh it in with all of the other things that they're considering, like making this override sustainable. We're just looking at what we need for FY18. They're looking at how long does the override last and what do we need to sock away to make it last. So they've got more complex things that they're looking at. So, perhaps the need to prioritize that list will come down the road, and we can maybe have that discussion when that time comes. But for now, I do what's emerged for me over the last few weeks is very clear. There's the $2 million structural deficit and another almost $2 million of other priorities, and we keep discussing them separately and talking about them separately, and they do seem to be two separate issues, important but separate. So, I would agree that that's where we're at.
One piece of information that I learned about recently, and I had a misunderstanding. On August 16th, the selectmen are voting to put the question on the ballot. They aren't necessarily determining a number that night. They don't need to. I think they're going to be probably waiting till after the financial forum on September 1st. I may be wrong, but that's the impression I got, that August 16th, they may not necessarily be deciding a number. They need to decide if it's going to be on the ballot.
Do you know if they have to decide wording or type on the ballot at that point? Or is it just, we will do this or we will not do this?
I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't know.
You and I have a meeting coming up very soon, yeah. And we should be able to get some clarity on this for the committee. So
I guess where I was going with that is that you may not need to, you may not need to prioritize right away.
Right, right. But we always can if that's a step that has to happen down the road. Mrs. Webb. Mrs. Webb, go ahead.
Okay, so, those dates are informative. I sort of feel like, though, this, September 1 hits me as, oh, my gosh, I'm, sort of don't want to keep waiting to make these decisions. I feel like we've been going over this. We've asked John to sort of put this back together a couple of times. I think you could go forward now and say, okay, now we have this information. We have the PowerPoints. I think the PowerPoints were great. You could sort of merge the PowerPoints and these documents and put together a presentation or, make sure they fit together. But I think we need to take a vote sooner than later about what we want to put forward and show the leadership to the community and say, look, this is what we, the school committee, have looked at. We've evaluated, we've analyzed it, we've talked about it. This is what we believe we need for this district going forward. And start to get that out there. I don't know if I'm ready to prioritize because, I'd have to keep looking. I'd have to be spending a lot of time with this because she's like, no, I'm not prioritizing because I can't on this list. I'm concerned about if we do that, does that mean we're going to give someone else the ability to sort of lop some number off somewhere? I think that's where my hesitancy about prioritizing is coming in because I just want to be able to look at this, to take my vote about what I think, this needs to be, and then put that out there. And I'm concerned that if we then, at some point if we prioritize, someone else is going to try to cross things off the list and say, well, yeah, we know what you said, you voted, but hey, this is a different number. So I'm glad we're not going to try to do that right now because I'm not ready. But I do feel like we should, sooner than later, it's the end of July, in August, we should sooner than later. If it's not Wednesday, then it should be very shortly afterwards that we're really addressing this and knowing where we are telling the community we need to be. So,
thank you.
Sort of surprised by the September 1st.
Mrs. Joyce.
So I apologize, but I missed the last meeting. I want to understand exactly what it is that we're voting on Wednesday night. To your point about trying to prioritize, what are we voting on? Are we voting on a full number? Are we voting on a number? What's the vote on Wednesday night?
Dr. Doherty and I will be working together on language for what to vote on Wednesday night.
We'll provide you with more information. We have a meeting tomorrow that we're hoping to get some more clarity.
Okay, I just need to know what I'm voting on.
It's a very good question.
Okay,
yep. It is.
So, I might have been Jean or John, I can't remember. Someone said the Board of Selectmen's having discussions with the Finance Committee about use of free cash.
Oh, I didn't.
No. I said that I've heard that discussion referenced in Selectmen's meeting. That question raised of $2 million is clearly unsustainable. Is there an amount that's sustainable, and what is that amount? It's a question that's been raised, no decision's been made.
Okay.
It's a discussion.
The $2 million
that's
free cash.
Not their decision.
In free cash.
We're currently,
it's not
am I using the right number?
No, $2 million is what has been used the last couple of years.
We're currently using $2 million, and I think everyone agrees that's unsustainable. But then the question is, well, do you do zero?
Yeah.
And there, people definitely think that That's, I shouldn't say people think. That's a discussion the FinCom is having.
That's a town meeting decision.
Yep.
And, but back to the, I agree. Why, waiting until September 1st is, I mean, that's cutting, when, so the election is in October, correct?
October, yes, it's in October. 18th, I believe.
Gives no time to work it.
I mean, we're 90% down the road here, and to make a decision on a number to give to the Board of Selectmen, and then they should, they've been having their discussions, they should package their number with our number, and that would be, I mean, I'm not trying to oversimplify it, but that's the, what would go on the ballot. And in terms of them being able to lop, they can't draw value judgments on different things in what our priorities are. They just can't do that. I mean, that they're not going to be able, and I don't think they would try to lop off, clerical support or whatever. But I think that, September 1st, I mean, we've all been sitting here and not taking vacations and having extra meetings to have this thing done by the August 16th, and now tonight I'm hearing it's September 1st.
My understanding is that they do not have to decide a number on August 16th. They just have to put it on the ballot or not put it on the ballot on August 16th. That's the decision that needs to be made by August 16th.
Okay, but whatever you put on the I think to your previous question, Gene, was how does the question, it can be worded a lot of different ways,
right.
And that, a lot of that will depend on what the number is.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So, just, yeah.
We're hoping to get more clarification.
Yeah, I think that's exactly where we're at, is we have a meeting scheduled tomorrow where John and I will ask a lot of these questions about what's the plan going forward, what are the dates, what's exactly going to happen when. They are already informed about where we're at in the process, so.
Yes, they're very well aware.
Right, so none of these numbers are going to be shocking. They know this is what we're discussing. So what I'm going to propose is we have our meeting tomorrow, we come back Wednesday night with information from the committee about what happens next. I will have a draft of motions to approve this. And I will say, Dr. Doherty and I have already alluded to it, I'm envisioning two separate votes. I'm not envisioning one vote. I'm envisioning a vote on the structural deficit number and a vote on unfunded investment numbers. And then as a committee, we'll make a determination that night based on the information we have. Is anything that we've heard mean that we need to wait on this? There's information we didn't have, or are we ready to move forward? So does that sound?
Yeah.
Like a plan moving forward.
Yeah.
Right. Two different votes too.
Mm. Oh, good. It felt like the discussion was kept leading us there.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
No, no.
I appreciate this. It's
welcome.
It's good information to go through before Wednesday.
Yeah. Any other questions on this document or the particular $3.9 million in investments? No. Anybody from the public have questions or comments this evening? 9:30 at night. Okay, so I mean, we're going to be discussing this in less than 48 hours. So to be continued again. But you know what, Ms. Robinson, you said we're 90% there. There is a light at the end of this tunnel, and it's been a productive discussion. It's an important topic, certainly. We do have time for reports, and I believe then executive session.
Yes, correct.
It is getting a little bit late, so I'll ask the committee if there are any reports that are urgent and or brief.
I'll be really brief.
Thanks, Mrs. Webb.
So the meeting last week at the Senior Center,
yes,
was really the CPDC zoning charrette. That is what it was. It was very informative if you wanted to learn a lot about 40R, 40B, and cared a lot about the business districts downtown. And there was a little bit of a summary of the selectmen's meeting from that previous week or Tuesday. Was that the same week? I don't know. That was a Thursday, so the Tuesday's meeting. A summary was presented about some of the work that the selectmen are doing. But really, it was, as advertised in the emails sent out by Maureen Knight, it was the zoning charrette. and
so not a lot of impact to the schools.
No, and there was a ton of people there from the Green Street area, you know, behind that Main Street district, and I know Linda and I both attended and took lots of notes, and there were a lot of the members of boards and committees were there, and I don't think everyone expected it to be simply the zoning charrette, but anyway, it was.
Thank you. Any other reports from the committee? Not for me. Dr. Doherty, from yours?
I do not have any, I don't believe.
We have no students? Linda, any reports? okay, yes, Mr. Robinson.
Move to enter into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to litigation and not to return to open session.
Second. Thank you. Roll call vote, Mr. Nyan?
Yes.
Yes. I'm a yes, Mr. Robinson?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. We're in executive session.
I don't know what that
I don't know what that word is either.
Company, a draft company,
yeah.